Hello students, myself Piraj Mojumdar. I welcome you today our video session on the series we are continuing on special casting processes, and we are having today the topic on centrifugal casting. So I again welcome you to MechPro classes. Please stick to this video till the end and we will learn the procedure of centrifugal casting, the different type of centrifugal casting actually, the advantages as well as the limitation and application portions also. Look, this centrifugal casting, previously we already discussed about the cell molding investment as well as the die casting also. Now this process is the process where mold is rotated, you know, the mold is to be rotated. You have to rotate the mold about a central axis, okay, as the metal is poured into it, okay. So metal will be poured into it and it will be rotated, okay. So it will be rotated. So that's why when you rotate, say you have a spring and you have a stone, so when you rotate, so it will develop a centrifugal force outside and direction would be away from the rotation, and inside it will be the centripetal force. So I'm not going into the physics of this centrifugal force and all that, but you should know that when it is rotated along a circle and its force is developed, which is known as the centrifugal force, okay. Now this centrifugal casting is also based on that particular concept of physics, you can say. So here the mold is rotated about its central axis, so it be the central axis, so it can be vertical or horizontal as well, okay. Similarly, okay, so it will be rotated as the metal poured into it, and because of the centrifugal force, a continuous pressure will be acting on the metal as it solidifies, okay. The slag, the oxides and other inclusions being lighter will get separated from the metal and segregates towards the center. This is a very important thing, you should take a note. The slag, the oxides and the other inclusions will be segregated towards the center. It is very important MCQ for your competitive examinations. So you can write towards the center, the slag inclusions as well, okay. Now there are mainly three commonly known, or you can say the type of centrifugal casting. First is your true centrifugal casting, okay. Next is your semi centrifugal casting. So we'll be discussing these three different types of centrifugal casting as well. And the last one is your centrifuging. So these are the mainly three parts of centrifugal casting we are going to discuss today. Look, I earlier told you that we will be having vertical as well as horizontal setup. We can use either of these, okay. Now coming to this true centrifugal casting, let us discuss how it happens, okay. Look, this process is generally very useful for making of hollow pipes, you can write hollow pipes, and tubes you can also write tubes, then hollow bushes. So these are all are axisymmetric, okay. So these are all axisymmetric in nature with a concentric hole, okay. So in this picture I am going to show you and discuss you the different procedure or step you can involved in this particular true centrifugal casting process, okay. Now look, since the metal is always pushed outward, as because it will rotate, let me first label the diagram. Look, these are your, this is this one and this one is your core. Okay, so this is the core. Now these are the bottom rollers. So you are seeing the front view, so it is showing like this. Actually they are the rollers. Okay, so here one roller, here one roller, and in between will be your system, and top here you will be having also two rollers. Okay, so it will be symmetric, you know, the rollers will be symmetric, somewhat same size. Okay, and it will, you know, rotate, it will also rotate, and eventually this thing will also rotate, and in between here will be your access line, and here will be the opening for pouring the molten metal, and this molten metal, you know, will eventually rotate with this device, and ultimately it will take the shape, and finally we will be obtaining the casting after the metal solidifies. Okay, now coming to this schematic diagram, these are your bottom rollers, these are your top rollers, and this one, a small lining is known as sand lining. Okay, now this one is your pouring basin, a different setup for this particular arrangement, centrifugal casting. You have to provide wheels so that it can move and it can provide molten metal to this particular cavity. Okay, now inside it will have a casting, say this one. So this one, say, will be the, you can say, is a casting. Okay, now this, you know, this is the flux, molding flux, you can say, and this is, you can say, as orifice. So small opening through which the molten metal will be coming out of this pouring basin as well. Okay, so this is in short the leveling of the schematic diagram for true centrifugal casting. Now what happens, look here, the metal is always pushed outward when it is rotating because of the centrifugal force, and no core needs to be used for making this, say, you know, concentric hole. Okay, now the center remains hollow, so this is also the process where you are not needing any core for producing the central, or you know, concentric hole. Now the axis of rotation, I already told you that it can either be horizontal one, or this axis is, you can see, is horizontal, or you can also have a similar in a vertical way like this one. Okay, so here will be the wheels, so it will be the vertical one, and it can also be at any angle in between. Okay, now very long pipes are normally cast with this, you know, horizontal axis, this horizontal axis, very long pipes. Okay, so you can take a note, very long pipes for this horizontal casting, for horizontal casting, this horizontal axis, you can say. Okay, while short pieces are more conveniently, you can cast with a vertical. For vertical, you can write short pipe pieces, you can write. Okay, pieces for vertical, you can write. Okay, now a normal, you know, centrifugal casting looks like this one, and what happens, first the molding flux, you can see the molding flux, this is the flux, is properly rammed with sand. So this is the sand lining, is to be rammed with sand to conform to the outer contour of the pipe to be made. Okay, and any end details such as spigot ends or flanged ends are obtained with the help of this course. Look, this is already hollow in the center, but if you are you know, if you want some flange style at the end, you are wanting some hollow sections. So in that case, you will be needing some cores, okay, to produce spigot ends or flange ends, okay, by the help of this dry sand cores located in the ends only, okay. Now the flux is dynamically balanced so as to reduce the occurrence of undesirable vibrations during the casting process. Now the finished flux is to be, you know, mounted in between the rollers and the mold is rotated slowly. Now the molten metal in requisite, you know, quantity is to be poured into the mold through the movable pouring basin. As I earlier told you that it is the movable pouring basin, so it will help in pouring the molten metal into the mold cavity as well, okay. And after that, the amount of metal poured determines the thickness of the pipe to be cast, okay. So after the pouring is complete, the mold is rotated, this one is rotated with the help of these top rollers and bottom rollers as well at its operational speed till it solidifies, okay, or until it solidifies, and it is to form the requisite tubing. You can say tubing means pipes, tubes as well, okay. Now the mold is replaced by a new mold machine and the process is again continued, okay. And I can also say that metal molds can also be used in true centrifugal casting process for large quantity production, and in that case you have to provide a, you know, water jacket around the mold for cooling it. The casting is mounted on wheels while with the pouring ladle, which has a long sprouts extending till the other end of the pipe is met. Now to start, the mold is rotated with the metal being delivered at the extreme end of the pipe. The casting machine is slowly moved down the track, allowing the metal to be deposited all along the length of the pipe. The machine is continuously, you know, rotated till the pipe is completely solidified. Afterwards, the pipe is extracted from the mold and the cycle is again repeated. So this is, you know, all about the procedure of true centrifugal casting. Now coming to the advantages part of true centrifugal casting, I can say the mechanical properties of centrifugally cast jobs are better in comparison to any other, you know, process. So mechanical properties are much better, okay, because of the inclusions such as the slag and oxides get segregated towards the center of the, you know, device and can easily removed by machining also, okay. And also the pressure acting on the metal throughout the solidification process, you can say, causes the porosity to be illuminated, giving rise to dense metal, okay. So now next one, up to a certain thickness of objects, proper direction solidification can be obtained from the mold surface to the center, you can write, okay. So you can write proper directional solidification you can obtain, okay, directional solidification, which will eliminate most of the casting defects. And no cores are required for making concentric holes, you can write no cores for making concentric holes, you can write. And there are no need of, this is also important, very important, you can write no need of, you know, gates and runners, as because it is under the pressure of centrifugal, you know, force. So runners you can write, so no need of gates and runners, which increases the casting yield reaching almost 100%. Now limitations, I can say only certain shapes which are axisymmetric, this is the limitation you can write, okay. So only axisymmetric and having concentric holes are suitable for this particular true centrifugal casting, okay. And the also, this is very common for every process, each and every process, you know, equipment is expensive and thus is suitable for, you know, large quantity production. Now let us discuss about semi centrifugal casting. Look, this is the schematic diagram for semi centrifugal casting, and this is the central core, you can say this is a central core, I'll show you this one with the multimeter, and this is the feeder, reserve. These are, so this is the feeder reservoir. Okay, now here will be your strainer core, and this is your, this is the pouring basin, and this is the, flux, you can say. Okay, this is the holding fixture. And this portion is the cope, and this portion is the track. Okay, and casting is this one, you can say. This one is the casting. Okay, so this is all you need to know in this particular schematic diagram as well, right? Now coming to the process, what does this signify? Semi-centrifugal casting. Look, it is generally used for the jobs which are more complicated than those possible in true centrifugal casting, but are axisymmetric in nature also. Okay, so it is not necessary that this should have a central hole, which is to be obtained with the help of a core. Okay, now the molds made of sand or metal are rotated about a vertical axis, and the metal enters into the mold through the central pouring basin. This is the pouring basin. Okay, central pouring basin. Now what happens, for larger production rates, the molds can be stacked one over the other, all feeding from the same central pouring basin. The rotating speeds used in this process are not as high in the case of true centrifugal casting. Now this is the last type of the centrifugal casting, that is the centrifuging, centrifuging. Okay, now look, this is the central sprue through which the molten metal will be fed, and it is, is a top view. So I will show you in this schematic diagram, in this cross-sectional view. So here will be your central sprue as well. Okay, now this is the reservoir for, for feeding, you can write. Okay, this one, this is the casting, so I will mark it with red. This one and this one, so this one, this is all the casting, this is also the casting, this one, this metal comes through this. Okay, now this is the core forming inside the cavity, you can write. Okay, core forming inside cavity, and this, these are the castings. Okay, so these are the castings, you can write. And this is the table, it is known as revolving table, it can revolve, revolving table. Okay, and this is the cope, and this is the drag. Okay, now this is the flux, flux. Okay, so this is this all you need to know for the schematic diagram of centrifuging. Okay, now in order to obtain higher metal pressures during solidification, when casting shapes are not axisymmetrical,
the centrifuging process is used. That is the main important thing you must note. This is suitable, you can write it somewhere, for small jobs of any shape. Small jobs of any shape, you can write any shape. Okay, so that is the versatility of the centrifuging process actually. So a number of such, you know, metal jobs are joined together by means of radial runners with a central sprue. This one, central sprue, okay, on a revolving table. Okay, now the jobs are uniformly placed in the table around the periphery so that their masses are properly balanced. This is also similar, you can say, in similar to the you know, semi-centrifugal casting as well. Okay, so this is, you know, about the centrifugal casting, about the different parts of the centrifugal casting. So in short, I can tell you that centrifugal casting mainly comprises of three mainly processes: true centrifugal, semi-centrifugal and centrifuging process. And in short, a casting process in which molten metal is poured and allowed to solidify while the mold is revolving is called as centrifugal process. The casting produced under this centrifugal force is called as centrifugal casting. And this process is specially employed for casting articles of symmetrical shape, you must keep in mind. Okay, and ferrous and non-ferrous, you can also, any type of metal, ferrous or non-ferrous, you can write. Okay, can be casted by this process. Okay, and coming to the advantage, I can say you that this casting produced by this process, the castings produced by this process have dense and fine grained structure due to of the centrifugal forces, and the slag will accumulated in the center. So you will obtain a fine grain and good surface finish, and mechanical properties will be very high enough. Okay, so that's all. Thank you very much. The last one of the special casting processes we are going to discuss is slush casting. Okay, this slush casting, also known as hollow casting, you can write hollow casting as well. It is a special process. It was first developed by William Britten. You need to know also William Britten in 1893. You know, for the production of special thing, you know, must know, for the production of lead, you can say lead toy soldiers. Okay, so for the production of toys, this great man William Britten in 1893 developed this particular special type of, you know, casting process that is known as, and is famous today also as, slush casting or hollow casting as well. Okay, now this is a process used to produce hollow casting without the use of core. That is the important highlighting point for you MCQ questions. Without the use of core, without use of core, you can write somewhere or take a note. Without the use of core, we are going to produce hollow castings by this particular slush casting method. So that is very important MCQ for your semester as well as competitive examinations. Okay, now coming to this process, let me draw the diagram for you. Okay, look, first you need to know, you have to develop you can say the mold. Okay, so you have to develop a mold. Say this is a arbitrary shape you can take. So let me take in this way, looks like amoeba. Okay, and it is in the first stage, say this is the mold. Okay, so mold, so this is the mold, and this will be the shape of the casting, final shape of the casting we are going to make. Now it is the initial stage, you can say, when the mold is ready for pouring. Okay, now in the second step, I must tell you, mold filled with liquid metal and partly solidified skin. I am just going to draw that diagram, so I will mark it with red for your better understanding. The mold now is, you know,
filled with, say, this one. This looks similar. So this is the highlighted portion I am trying to highlight you, and inside you know, liquid metal. So I will just mark it with red only. So it is the molten metal inside, and it is the border, you can say. This is the border. Okay, so in this step you can write mold filled with liquid metal and partly solidified skin as well. Okay, and the rest remains same. And this is your mold ready for pouring, you can write. Okay, now you have to turn it up. Now turning up, upside down, you can say, it will produce a, you know, mold similar to this one. Okay, so this one. Okay, now when you move it up or turn it upside down, the excess metal will just drain out, and the rest of this looks similar to the previous ones also. Okay, so this one. Now the final casting will look somewhat like this one. You have to take this out of this mold. Now the final casting, say, will look like this one. Okay, so this one will be your, you can write as final casting. So in short, I can again repeat you for you, this is the process to, you know, produce hollow castings without the use of core. I'm stressing this word more than a time to remind you that it is very important for your competitive examinations as well. Okay, now the tools used are relatively cheap and produce a casting that is lighter. This is very much lighter, you can take a note. So the casting will be very much lighter and less expensive product, you can also say. Okay, expensive product. And generally it uses permanent mold without any course. So you can write it also, it uses permanent mold without, I'm writing in short, without any course, you can write. Okay, so it is very important, permanent mold it is again using. And the casting starts solidifying from the mold, you know, towards the inside of the casting. Okay, so after a certain wall thickness is formed, the mold is inverted. This mold is inverted. Okay, to let the excess liquid, you know, drain out of this mold. So excess liquid have to be drained out, that's why we are turning upside down, to remove the excess liquid. Okay, and then the mold is opened and the casting can be taken out from it. So this is the final casting. So you know, this process in short I can say you is a special application involving the use of a permanent mold, and it is used for casting low melting you know, temperature alloys. One more important thing is, it is usually used for casting low melting temperature alloys, you can write temperature alloys. Okay, so and this method, the use is very 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 important, you must take a note. It is particularly used for making ornaments and toys of non-ferrous alloys. Okay, so these two uses, they are very favorite for the examiners, paper setters of the competitive examinations. they will be asking you which of the method, casting method, is generally employed for making of the ornaments as well as the toys. So you must keep in mind this application is very important of this slush casting method. Okay. So in short, this is all about the slush casting method, and we have completed our special casting processes as well. So we will generally now move on to the casting defects, and we will also try to solve some of the numericals that are generally asked during your examinations as well as gate examinations, and based on the solidification time, riser design, as well as the gate design also. So stick with MechPro classes. We'll try to provide you more and more quality videos on mechanical subjects. Hope you will enjoy it and will learn a lot. Thank you for watching. If you have any comment, please comment in the comment section. Thank you very much.